unrealistic valuations we've been spoken about. Your Hotmail.com valuation for a company of hardly 1.5 crore turnover and a loss of 50 lakhs plus, getting sold for 1,000 crores plus. You know, some of these magical news was there all over the place, and we also went to the new business model and took the venture capital at that point in time. That's almost 19 years back, but I remember the palpable anxiety and excitement in the mind of entrepreneurs who all started these three buzzwords, started chanting these buzzwords as something really new at that time. The new economy, worldwide people were talking of the new world economic order, and there was very, very, even in the literature which got published at that time, there were very, very different kind of things which were getting put up. Like, for instance, The World is Flat was an important book which came around that time. There are at least 100 books which have followed that, which ask the question, is the world really flat or it's not flat? Okay. And the gist of that book was that the world has changed. It's almost like overnight the world, which is elliptical, is turned flat. The many levelers of the world, 10 levelers of the world, which has changed the world from the entrepreneurship point of view, where if you have a scale and one pan is wealth, another pan is ideas. The pan which has ideas has gone down, and the pan carrying wealth has gone up. You don't have to have your own money to invest in start a business kind of ideas, which started phenomenally. They were really, really growing like anything at that point in time. So that time when my business got transformed, our business got transformed, we started looking at many, many new business models. And I think then we were the first company to cross 10 crore in this highly fragmented industry. We were the first to cross 100 crores. We were the first to cross 1,000 crores. We were the first public limited in this industry. But to me, after that, of course, 2010, we sold the business, bought the brand back, had a cooling off period, restarted recruitment and staffing under the name of CL. We were also one of the first to franchise HR services, like my good friend CKK, who must have given you a lot of insights from The Natural Story, which is one of the first professional franchising organizations. Called the business partners, I think. So, like that, we also did maybe 10 years earlier the idea of franchising in HR services, which worldwide was seen as a failure model. But in India, we made that to be success. Because, in my view, if an FMCG company or a consumer durable company could do a business partner model where a large portion of their business passes through these so-called channel partners. And this is again something which has been transforming over many years. What the idea of franchisee to the idea of a channel partner. To me, it was an idea waiting to be exploited. We did that, and we could, in the first phase, move to 142 locations, which gave us depth of access to the whole country, with which we could win mandates from blue-blooded multinationals like Unilever or P&G or any of them who wanted people to be based in the nook and corner of the country. So it was very helpful for them to have office spread of a certain kind. And then we took the same idea overseas. We were in 14 countries and things like that. So I think there are many things which have happened in this period of 18 years that we ran the business in phase one. This phase two, of course, we went into Stanley Consulting and analytics and research, and of course we went into recruitment and staffing again. So that's briefly the business story of mine. But if, as Ravina has asked me to do, you're the holistic life coach, the kind of meanings I had In this 18 years of entrepreneurial journey and another 9 years of working for someone, you know, after which of course I came into politics. Politics has been about 9 years. In my view, politics is the ultimate entrepreneurship, where all the lessons of entrepreneurship that you could, you know, deploy into politics. In many sense, I think working with limited resources or innovating within the span that you have, asking questions of the established values, where you live your values but in an ambience of a certain kind, your party, boundaries of that kind, and of course the idea of leadership. Many of it, I think, is a huge transference within entrepreneurship and political universe, in my view. So coming back to the idea of the circle of success, you know, the concept, whatever Ravina has curated this entire day's program, in my view, success in business, in entrepreneurship, is like a dance within these three points. The first point is scale, scope, and depth. Exactly like the way, you know, I've seen many entrepreneurs who have failed. Most of them who have failed have not managed the balance between scale, scope, and depth correctly. Often they've been blind to the fact that with every dynamic step that you take, year one, year two, year three, year four, the balance between these three forces change. You know, you have scale of a certain kind with the same level of scope, your depth goes for a six. Okay, you need to find ways of infusing more depth. It could be financial depth, it could be management bandwidth, it could be thinking through to generate intellectual property in your businesses. Because intellectual property is the one which gives you quantum leaps in terms of valuations, in terms of any of those things. Often people make the mistake of being excessively in action and losing the time to reflect. Though often in the entrepreneurial pursuit, most entrepreneurs tend to become very lonely very early. So lonely that their reflection often becomes a preoccupation. It doesn't become a very constructive, creative journey. It often becomes a preoccupation. And then you start working like a robot in terms of doing the same thing again and again and again. And you have very little time to, as Milton says, to stand and stay. They also said, who stand and stay. Poetry can often teach great management lessons. In my view, in my experience, there are many moments when insights, entrepreneurs don't allow them to let the insights bubble up their minds. They'll be so preoccupied, so they are so repetitive in what they do. So one of the first lessons I learned is to have periodic phases of collective reflection. We call it institutional meets. Initially we used to do it once in 3 months. All the key people sit together. We were only 7 of us in 1994 when we first did the institutional meet. When the last institutional meet I did in the, around the 2009, we had a room full of 300 people who were part of the institutional meet. Because by the time the company had grown to 72,000 people strong. So we had this very religiously, assiduously, every year, do an institutional meet where it's purely dedicated to reflection on how far we've gone on our mission, what kind of changes are happening around us, and what kind of relationships are getting built among the core people, who are the core people, who are the people who bear the building of PAWFA, you know, who are the pillars which hold together the building of PAWFA. And it's really focused on re-looking at the structure, systems, strategies and processes to align ourselves with the mission. And anybody can ask a question. It's a, you know, done in a very process model, as they call it. And it's a very creative, it's a collective space for created reflection. It's what we created there. In my view, entrepreneurs, as they go in their growth journey, need to give themselves spaces for reflections, spaces for asking questions of themselves, allowing the space for recalibration. This is one lesson which I learned, which I'd like to present to you. The second is constantly keeping your emotional well-being alive. You know, as they say, many entrepreneurs, you know, the recent Central Statistical Organization data talks about the number of suicides, you know, among different categories. You know, the category which has the highest percentage of suicides, guess who? It's the entrepreneur. It's not the student, it's not the lovelorn characters, it's the entrepreneurs. Because in India, the kind of psychological background an entrepreneur comes with, and the drivers that entrepreneur has, often you drive yourself in a situation. Even a Siddharth, you know, Siddharth is only an extension of many, many entrepreneurs who commit suicides. I'm making a very calibrated statement, but I've experienced many of them. Even Siddharth, I have known him through the YPO circuit or whatever, which I'm a part of. And the kind of intense processes which get unleashed in an entrepreneur's life. Okay, now the bankruptcy law is there. Government is trying to make, like California, where losing is seen as a badge of honor to get up and walk ahead with your head held high. But I think it gives you minds to go in terms of providing support mechanisms to entrepreneurs. You need to create your own support mechanism in those moments. Because here, an entrepreneur makes commitments. An entrepreneur, holds the responsibility for a host of people. In this case of Siddharth, see the multiple number of people you make commitment to. And often, the stress of not being able to see what's coming, and especially when in Siddharth's case where politics and business had come together, the kind of stresses that he must have had. Of course, there is also an angle of family here in this case where his wife and the relationship that he had with her and all kinds of complications. In a way, the framework of circle of success that Praveena has put out, I really feel you could use to analyze this case, whether it's the physical part, the intellectual part, the emotional part, the financial part, social part, spiritual part, all of it coming together in that moment of stress for an entrepreneur. How often do you see, almost every second day, you'll see one entrepreneur committing suicide with his family? You know, in Tamil Nadu, it's very, very common, especially the financial services industry has been very prone to that. And of course, many industries where there's a high level of indebtedness which the person has, and the conscience plus inability to see things outside plus inability to give one a reflective space and an absence of a support system creates this disaster. In my view, when Modi says that entrepreneurs, or what he calls as wealth creators, are the new soldiers of independent India in his address in the last Independence Day. I was asking myself, in the sense, the kind of soldier identity that all of us take as entrepreneurs, where has it led us to? In some sense, we need to have the soldier identity balanced with the monk identity, the identity of a monk who has a reasonable degree of detachment from your pursuit. You know, the soldier identity is something where I'm there to kill, live, or, you know, I mean, die. I'm going to be there achieving my mission, kind of a thing. So my honest submission to you is, can you be a soldier and be a monk? That's my, you know, invitation to you. So to me, the circle of success, what our lady is putting together, in the circle of success, can you hold the spiritual component of yourself, spiritual, not religious, but some conversation with the deepest spirit that drives you, some engagement with the spirit within. Can you found your institution on the bedrock of your own spirit and not on a host of other parameters? And then you will be able to take a failure on your stride, and not internalize onto it or take it on as part of your identity. I am a failure, rather than saying my business is a failure. I will fall and I will get up and rise, and not take excessive ownership of success or failure, which is what the monk mindset, as they call it. The monk mindset of Gita says, Sthitapragyan means someone who is as firm as rock, not touched by success or failure, crudely put. But, you know, that part of existence we will need to start moving towards. And don't get excessively hooked on to the macho hero identity of an entrepreneur. There are as many forces outside you which will determine whether you will succeed or fail as the internal forces that you generate for yourself. You know, that humility to accept that, okay, this is God's will, kind of a stance that the spiritually inclined may say. But at least have the humility and the reality, realism to accept that there are far more forces around you which will determine. If Mafa had done well and valued excellently by the investors at some point in time, the credit is as much to the 278 classmates and friends of mine who put in very small equity, 3,000 rupees to 30,000 rupees in the beginning. What is probably now called as crowdsourcing is what we attempted, but we did that over 6-7 years. And it's as much attributable to those friends of mine and Lata as it is to the large venture capital, the third richest Indian in the world, Apoor Bhagri, who, you know, put in his money there, or many others, or the third largest bank in India, Canara Bank, which put in some money, as much as it is to the forces around us which got unleashed during the time, the forces of LPG, the liberalization, privatization, globalization model that got unleashed in 1992 when the company of Mafa was born, or, you know, later when the kind of discontinuities in the market, many markets, the financial services market, the media and entertainment market, all of those provided opportunities for the deputy.